All right, so every time we come back to class, we have to set ourselves up in order to learn something new. And that will be one of two things. That will be that you either set up your real device. Remember the handout about getting your driver, installing it, and all of that. So you're either going to set up your real device or you're going to create a virtual device. And sometimes you're going to do both, actually, because you might want to test on your real device and then test on a virtual device that is larger. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk us through, if you need to remember how to set up a virtual device, I'm going to do that right now, but it's in one of the handouts. And while I'm doing that, I would recommend you take a moment to set up your real device if you've got a real device. Now, I said previously, if you've got a Motorola device, I've already got the drivers for Motorola's on all of these computers because mine's Motorola and I want it to be up and running quickly. I don't have the LG driver, I don't have the Samsung, I don't have the HTC and the, you know, whatever brand you have. I've only got the Motorola one set up. So while I'm guiding us through the virtual one, you need to look at your handout for your to set up the real one. It's handout number 3A. Go ahead and do that, and I'm going to talk about setting up the virtual one, which is also like handout 2 or something. So let's go to computer window, open up computer, then open local disk C, and then we're going to see program files x86, not the regular old program files, the one that says program files x86. Open that. And then at the top you will see Android. Open the Android folder. You'll see Android SDK Windows. Open that. And then you will see the AVD Manager. Question? The x86 one, yes. And then here you will see AVD Manager, the Virtual Device Manager. Go ahead and click, double-click that to launch it. You might get a quick flash of the command prompt, and then eventually you'll get something like this. In our particular labs, we've got the Nexus 5 built in. You probably won't have that built in when you do this at home. I just have this to work to get up and running quickly. And another class also teaches Android. But I don't recommend to use this one because it's perhaps a little more hefty. It requires more resources. So what I like to do is use the lower powered one. And remember, we've set this up before. We'll do it again together. So at the top, you've got Android Virtual Device tab and Device Definitions. Click on Device Definitions. These are the templates for all of the Android types of devices we can work with. So if we wanted to create apps to see how they look on, you know, Android Wear, which is the watch, the templates are here. I'm going to scroll down, and we're going to find here 3.2 ADP2, 3.2-inch QVGA ADP2, not the 3.2-inch slider, 3.2-inch QVGA. Click on that once, and then on the right side, select Create AVD. Yeah, they call it Create AVD or Create Device, so they should choose better names. But we want Create AVD. You get the screen here. Don't worry about a name. Device, that's fine. Target, switch your target from Android 5.1 to Google APIs. And that should automatically then select Google APIs for the CPU. You can't select that until you selected the Google API target. Leave alone hardware keyboard turned on. Skin, change that to skin with dynamic hardware controls. We can't select a front camera, so don't worry. And we've got back camera. Go ahead and click back camera and select emulated. Don't change memory. Don't change internal. And on SD card, we'll just type 99. Any value will work. but I just type 99. And no other changes. We don't need to change anything else here, then go ahead and click OK. It doesn't seem like it's responding. Most of the time at this point when you click OK, it might even say not responding. Just wait a moment and then eventually it will pop up right here to say you've created a device with all of these things. Just click OK. That takes you back to the Android Virtual Device screen right there. And we've got the AVD we just created with that name and the one that was already there. We want to use this one here, the 3.2-inch one, so click on it once. And then on the right side, select Start. From here, you don't change anything, just click Launch. Then you let it start. This is what I mean about every time we come in, you need to set yourself up. We did it together right now. We did it together a previous day. I've got it in a handout. Remember my handouts. If you haven't printed the handouts, you can do so later. The printer is noisy, remember. So the handouts are in that network folder. And we'll just wait a moment because it takes a moment the first time. This is why I want to set ourselves up. I want you to set yourself up in the beginning. It takes a moment for this thing to boot up, just like your own real phone. When you turn it on and turn it back, when you turn it off and turn it back on, it takes a moment to boot up, like your computer. So instead of us being in the middle of the lecture and then we do Taco Run Android and then we're waiting for this to start, you need to get this started. I'm going to have mine ready to go so that the lecture's ready, you know, within the first 5, maybe 10 minutes. I'd like you to have it all ready so that we can get our lecture started. That's what you need to do if you don't have a real device. Create the device and launch it. If you do have the real device, again, you need to download your particular driver, double-click it to run it. Once that's set up, you plug in your device. The driver needs to be installed every time, unfortunately, because these things don't remember. We have deep freeze. So either when you've got your mobile device set up or your virtual device will go on. That's actually coming back over here. So eventually it'll start up like this and you just want to leave it hanging around there. You don't have to do anything with it. Just, you know, let it run right here so that when we start to use our, write our code and do Taco Run Android or Taco Emulate Android, we've got something to show for it. So. Mine's ready, but maybe yours is not. Does anyone need a little help to get to this point so that we're all on track?
Anyone else, is your virtual device or your real device working?
So I'm done with this.
It's a nice lightweight open source software instead of huge Eclipse. Whatever you're doing right now, it might be you don't last. There's no reason for you to use Labs. You don't download any of the software scenarios unless you're downloading it. You still want to download the performance from Transactions to download. I just think of the JavaScript.
Yes. Has it been negative done more than once, or has it been installed like this a while?
Off your drive.
Yeah,
it might have remembered from the previous day, but it's probably 82% backup. I think just the first time, the very first time of the day, it's MSC. And then after that, it should be much faster. So, it doesn't quite matter. I would rather be one level above, but it doesn't seem to matter.
Did everyone get a chance to sign in? All right, so right now it's taking us a little moment to set up, but that's why when you come in next time, you need to set yourself up as soon as possible, either your real or virtual device. And some of us are seeing some quirks here and there that it doesn't seem to want to put it onto the device. What seems to be that issue sometimes is, you know, you think you set everything up, but it still wants to go to the virtual device, even though you never said anything about a virtual device. What could happen is oftentimes something popped up on your screen that said allow debugging, and then when you realize it and click OK, the taco has already passed by because you didn't answer it. It then went off to the emulator. So then I have to say OK on the device, run taco again, and then it'll see your device. And then for a few people also what seemed to be necessary is it seems that if you specify taco run Android --device, that one also seems to force it to go to the device just in case it's not behaving. But there's so many instances of this stuff working once you just do it again. I don't have an answer for you, I just do it again and it works. With so many examples of myself and students. So hopefully everyone's got something running, virtual or real. Proof of concept then, if we're on track, is to see does it really, really work? Here's what we'll do now. You can close now the virtual device. The virtual device manager. Close the virtual device manager, not the virtual device, or else you'll have to wait for it every time to pop up again. I'm just going to move it off to the side here. What we want to close is the virtual device manager. You can also close your program window there. Taking a step back at what we've got so far on the previous days, we created a template 1 week ago. It was called template. Then on Tuesday, I worked on a copy of my template with a new date, and I added to it the graphics and a little bit of JavaScript for the splash screen and such. Now, ideally then, let's say at this point my template is done. My template is ready for me to use for subsequent apps. And to make more apps, all I need to do is to make a copy of my template project folder. So either the one that you have or the one that I have in my network folder, you want your template file either yours from your flash drive or mine that I've made for you on my network folder. You want a copy of that. And the way I'm going to do it is, I'm going to do it as if I was you. I see the instructor's project in the network folder. And then I'm going to open a folder for my flash drive. And I've got a folder called apps. In apps, I'm going to copy from the network folder from the instructor's network folder, I'm going to copy the work, the template, over to my flash drive. That might take a moment, but that's going to then copy over, and that's going to be finally my real project from last month, the MySDCE project. We're going to import our work and start to add a bunch of cool Cordova features, you know, like the camera and databases, social media sharing, and all of that cool stuff that are real. Device can do. You notice that this is gonna take a moment, so you have to decide this. You have to decide, am I gonna copy the instructor's work every day? And remember, I'm gonna give you some time in the beginning of the day to set yourself up, because at a certain point I'm just gonna get running. So you're either gonna copy my work or you're gonna continue to use your project day after day after day. Hopefully you're following along and it's working and you can do that. If something goes wrong, get a copy of mine, compare my code with your code. You see here, for me it's taking, you know, 2.5 minutes to copy this over. Probably because we're all doing it. Because I said, let's all do it now. But if you come in and you copy it right away at the beginning when there's less network traffic, it might go by faster. And now I have to stall for 2 minutes, 15 seconds. So what's the weather like today? Question. Not quite working. Okay. While this is done right here, then.
Yes or no? Is that not one of the things that's take up another second? No, because then after you install that, then through code, you're going to install top of it. It's almost like it's a mess. Because you have flux of data. You can see the institution of data. So once you have those set up, you're going to put it on there and install top of it. What is close and that's what the next is. It's like from the central app repository.
All right, so mine copied over, and this is what I'm saying about setup. So the cool thing about doing it this way is that any folder that is a Taco project is a complete project. I don't have to do anything like export it out of Android Studio, let's say, to bring it into another computer, and I don't have to refactor and reset my paths and all of that. The whole thing is self-contained. The thing is that you just need to have Taco installed on the subsequent computer you take it to. It's all self-contained, and it's all that folder there. So I copied that out of my network folder, and I'm going to change the name of that folder. I'm going to call it My SDCE. Now the way I'm going to do this is that I'll work on my project, we'll do our work, and then I'm going to put a copy of my work into the network folder at the end of the day in case you want a copy. But probably you yourself are going to use your same project every day from now till the end of the month. And so I've got my project here. You want to open MySDCE. It came from the template, so it's complete. It's got the Android platform and the browser platform. Open MySDCE, and then let's edit that config file, because that config file still references the old template app, not the new, you know, real app that we're working with. So you should see config.xml, right-click it. Edit with Notepad++. And notice this widget. The unique domain name, template. This is no longer my template project. This is my SDCE project. If you would like, you can put your own last name there. But the big idea is that dot whatever, that needs to be the name of the folder or the name of the project. Technically, it doesn't need to be the name of the folder, but it's the name of your app in the App Store. So that will be MySDCE. This is all lowercase. So change that to your last name and then MySDCE. Remember what I said about versions right here? That can be anything you want, but you might as well put today's date. This is version 1.0.2016.3.10. Android version code, we're keeping that at 1. This is still the first version that we will eventually upload to the app stores. That's the name of the project, or of the app, once it's installed onto the device, once it's sold on the App Store. We don't want it to be called Template App. We want it to be called your last name, MySDCE. And here I can use spaces and capitals and all of that. So the point of this is that I can take my template file, my template project that I created, make a copy of it, and just change these few little things, and you've got a brand new app. It's ready. It's got all your foundation of the Android software, the browser software, the plugins that you might have added, any features that you might have done. You just change a couple of these little things like this. It's a brand new app. You don't have to go through the whole process again of Taco create MySDCE, Taco platform add iOS, Taco build blah blah blah. You just copy the folder. It's all self-contained. Make your changes. And there's very little changes to make. I still want a splash screen. I still want the portrait. I still want this and that. Time saver. What might be useful to change is the description. This is not really visible to most regular people unless they dig into it inside of your app. But this is going to be the unofficial SDCE app. Author. You can put your email address. Make one up, doesn't matter. On href right there, on line 5, you've got a web address. If you don't have a real website, don't worry. You can fill it in fake or real or later. I'm just using the same one here, just making up a name. I'm also making up a name right here of the actual app development company. Doesn't matter. This is not real. We're learning real things, but if you want to make up a fake company for this project, that's fine. Just plug it in. Besides that, we don't need to change anything else. This is all ready. We're going to have an app that's going to be in portrait mode. I suppose it might matter the background color. Right now it's like a baby blue color, so we might have to change that later. I don't know what colors yet to put on my app. These versions of Android, yes, this is the minimum version of my Android project, meaning that older devices can't run it, but again, at a certain point, it doesn't make much sense to still support the old devices. And the icon was set up properly and the splash screen, so we don't have to change anything else. Go ahead and save this file. And close the file. And to see the result, I want to launch it on my device. I want to launch it in my device, so that means I need the command prompt. The way I like to do this is, I'm in the project folder, MySDCE. I'm going to back up one level so that I'm outside like that. I want to open the command prompt so that I can work with this project. So I just backed out of the folder. And remember the trick, hold shift and right click to be able to select open command window here. We could go to the start menu and launch node and then navigate to that folder if we remember how to do that. Or if we simply shift right click, open command window here, and then we get the command prompt. Don't worry that it says on top, that it doesn't say at the top node. This still all works just fine. And to confirm we're on track, some of you already done this, but I'm going to type taco platform. That will simply check my project to make sure if it's a compatible taco project. It's very easy to accidentally sometimes think that you're working with a complete project and you go to taco run, and then you get a bunch of errors. So I usually here just do a quick taco platform. On mine it's gonna take a quick moment here because mine's not ready yet. But it'll then check it and it should output that it has Android version 4.1.1 and browser 4.0. and see what it says. Again, set yourself up. Instead of watching me like this, I should do it before we get started. So our workflow is that we're going to now be using that MySDCE project. Once this is set up and once I actually run it, because I set up my virtual device, it's hanging around, or I set up my real device, I'm not 100% if it works yet, I will know once I actually run a project onto it. I just wanted to check here. Yes, installed platforms, Android 4.1.1 and browser 4.0. If yours is different, that's okay, but you need to make sure that yours has at least Android. If it doesn't have browser, that's okay. But if it doesn't have Android, that's not okay, because then you're not going to be able to run an Android app. And if you are missing a platform, don't type this, but if you're missing a platform, taco platform, add Android. Don't do this. You've already got it. It's in the notes. We've done it together. But this particular project, if you took mine from the network folder, is ready. Taco platform add Android. That's already done. And so I want to see this. I have a virtual device set up. Taco. Emulate. Android. If you've got a real device, Taco. Run. Android. I'm running a virtual device, but it won't pop up to show me. So if you're waiting and waiting and nothing happens, well, make sure your device is there, visible. And so if you've got a real device, you're going to run taco, you're going to type taco run Android, and the first time you do it, when you come in, this is why I also want you to do it as soon as possible. The first time you do it, it might have to do a little bit of this, you know, prep work. That's going to slow us down in the middle of the lecture, but you want to do it as soon as possible. So I guess while I'm waiting here, everyone on track? Anyone need a little help? So as this gets started, do you remember a month ago when the class started how I had to turn people away? I didn't have enough space. And then now here, 1.5 months into it, we have less and less people. So that always happens with these classes. It's very exciting to get started, and unfortunately it is complicated. It is complicated to set all of this up. There's a lot of software, a lot of commands, a lot of trial and error. I make it look so easy, but I've been teaching this class for 3 years nonstop, so it gets easier and easier. For your own endeavors, try it at home. Make mistakes, make notes. You shouldn't be waiting only to do stuff here in class. You need to do it at home on any computer you can get your hands on. This is free. So that when you try it on your own and I'm not around, who's going to answer your questions? Stack Overflow? Yes.
Have a third part coming up,
is that right? Part three next month after we're done with this class. That's when we're going to focus on. We've got a great app. Well, we need to talk about actually publishing it. We actually need to go create a developer's account and actually publish it to a real app store for people to really download it.
Is it true that you are offering a certificate program in the fall?
I don't know if it's in the fall. Probably in the fall, but yes, this sequence of classes has been approved by the state for a certificate program. And maybe as early as the fall, this class will be around and you can take it and get a certificate.
Can we have some priority somehow? How do we get my first in line set?
I don't make those rules. So short answer, no. Yes? Just show up 2 hours early, it's okay.
Certificate program, is it?
It's the same class, basically, but I think I have to add more stuff to it. And then also, when you pass the whole sequence, you will get a certificate that says, you know, it's not an associate degree, and it's not a bachelor's or anything, but it is an official college certificate that says you completed this course and you are skilled in this skill. Okay, here we go. So, eventually, the project loads, splash screen, that cuts out at a certain point because the APIs are ready, and then the app is ready. Question in the back? Question back there, guys? If it's not working on a device, at the very least, I would say try to make it work on an emulator so that we're not falling behind. All right, so this is working. I'm going to move on now. Again, if yours is not quite working, we have had 44 minutes to get all of this working. So I've got some handouts here. I got another handout, actually, back in the network drive. Let's go to the network and get this new handout. Let's open computer. Classroom data drive Z as in zebra. Scroll down to find Campos Android 2. And I've got number 7, importing a web app in app browser. Copy that to your desktop or flash drive. You can print it later. And this is the point also now, that if you don't have your project from last month, I've got you covered right there. That is the end result project from last month. I'm also going to get a copy of that. If you have yours from last month, you can use it. But I'm going to copy that to my flash drive. Don't put it into your project folder yet. I'm going to copy it to my flash drive, because I've got a folder on my flash drive that I created called apps. And my projects, my Android or iPhone projects, are in there. I've got other stuff elsewhere. I'm going to copy that project from last month into my flash drive just so that I have a copy of it. And then we'll look at the handout. We'll look at it in general, the handout. Then we'll go into it step by step. So I copied the handout. I copied last month's work, because now it's time to upgrade that project from last month into an app. Let's see the handout in general. How to import the HTML5 web app project from last month. The big idea is that this current template project has its own files, its own supporting structure. It has its own index file. Last month's project also has an index file. If we simply dragged and dropped our stuff from last month into this month's project, what will happen is that it will erase that index file, and we will lose a little bit of code, actually, that we need to use now that we've got a Cordova project, a Taco project. So I'm saying here in a moment, we will rename our index file. We don't want to delete it yet. And then we're going to copy basically all the stuff from last month into this month's project. And then we need to copy some code from index to the temporary Cordova code. We're going to copy this together, of course, into my index file from last month to take over the index file of this project. I'm going to remove a little redundant code. We're going to remember to do that for the DIR file. Remember, our project works in that we've got an index file, which is just about every screen on that project. And then there's a directory file, which is the map. We need to remember to do what I listed here on the map as well. We need to copy a little bit of CSS from our template file into our project file. We're going to copy a little bit of JavaScript from the template file into our MySDCE project. Remove some stuff here and there. Then after we copy that old code, then we will delete the old stuff. We don't need that old index file and those old script files because we've got the one from last month updated. Then we'll do Taco build and Taco run or Taco emulate. And then, basically, the project we worked last month is now an app. So obviously, I make it sound so easy. Let's give it a try. So what I'm saying here is, I'm going to open two windows just so that I can see both.
I've got one window over here with last month's project. And then I've got a window here with this month's project.
Inside of my SDCE, open that up. Inside of WW folder, open that. And that index file, go ahead and right-click rename so that we can rename it over to anything else. I'll just call it index2. As long as it's still not called index, because when we copy one to the other, it'll erase. It'll overwrite it. Call that simply index2. We are dealing with two different projects. Be careful you're in the right place. I'm in the www folder of the app. That's what I renamed, not last month's project. So rename that. And then from my mobile website folder from the last class, copy every file into the www folder.
You enter one or enter two?
Well, if you copied it from my network folder, it doesn't matter, but it's Android 1.
My project from last. It's in the Android 2 folder, and the very first folder at the top is the one from last month.
So in last month's project, I open up my project, and then I open up mobile website, and this is my complete project from last month. I'm going to select all of this and simply drag it over or copy and paste. I'll just drag it. It might say, you've already got an images folder. That's fine, just click yes. Those will combine.
So now in the My SDCE app, WW folder, I've copied the stuff in from last month. There's where I had my images, there's the jQuery stuff, the map, the Codeca external CSS and JS,
and the index file from last month.
I need to take some code from index 2 back into index.
So my handout says, you will copy several lines of code from index 2 to index. So place these below the meta car set, blah, blah, blah. So what I mean by that is, in the folder, I want to edit both the index file and index 2. You can select them both. You can click one and then control click the other to select them both. And then right click one of them and you can edit them both in Notepad at the same time. So I'm going to select index. I'm going to select index 2. Right click one of those. Edit with Notepad++. And I need to take some code from index 2
into my current index. Isn't there a way for me to show my code side by side?
Yes.
What is that way?
It was...
Right-click the tab. Move to other view. So right-click your index tab. Move to other view.
So we see the code of the template index file, and we see the code of our project file.
And I'm saying in the handout, on index, I'd love to call it index 1, but you know there's no number there. On index, below the meta car set on that line 5, we're going to add, according to the handout, meta HTTP equivalent, meta name MS app, meta name viewport. We're just going to copy that over from here. You see, we've got line 8, meta content security policy, meta format, meta MS app, meta viewport. This viewport is slightly different than the one already there, so we're actually going to replace it too. So select lines 8 through 12. From the old index file, lines 8 through 12. Copy that. And then on line 5 of the index, paste it.
So that brought over the content security policy, format detection, MS app, viewport.
I've already got a viewport there, so we're going to delete the old viewport, and you're going to delete the line that says Apple Mobile Web App. Line 10, 11, and 12, those are no longer relevant. I'm going to delete those on the index file. I'm going to clean up my lines a little bit here. I've got an empty line 10, and I'm also going to delete an empty line 6. This is optional, but if we leave those two lines and I tell you to go to line 17, they're off a little bit. So notice I don't have any extra spaces here. And now my index file says head, meta car set, content, policy, format, MS app, viewport, title. That's what my new index file should show. Everything that I'm talking about, of course, is in those handouts. I'm going to go through them in a moment, and then I'll do help in a moment, but I'm going to go through all my steps because I wrote them down. If you're falling a little behind, check those steps. But we'll do some help in a moment. The next step. So I copied these lines of code. Number two here. Place this below jQueryMobile.js. Notice it's bold because you've got a line that says jQueryMobile.css and jQueryMobile.js. So we're going to add this line of code, which is in the index file, over to after this jQuery line. So let's orient ourselves here on the index 2 at the bottom, line 21, there is a line of JavaScript. It's referencing the Cordova.js library. It's referencing all of the Cordova goodness, all of it that translates our JavaScript into Android code or iPhone code or Windows code. It's all in there. So line 21, I'm going to copy that, and I need to find where I've got my jQuery mobile line on my index file. We put it all the way at the bottom. Be careful, don't put it at line 10 because that's the CSS file. We want it all the way at the bottom. Somewhere we put, there we go, on mine, it's on line 297. 297, 300 lines of code on our project, and that's a little project. jQuery mobile, blah, 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 JS. Make a new line, 298, and paste that code in. And now our project can access all of the features of Cordova. Our project can now take a photo, can access the accelerometer of the device, and the contacts, and all that cool stuff that a real app can do. Without that line, if we forget that line, our project will load up and kind of work, but it won't be able to do any of those app-specific things. It'll still be like a website. A website can't access my accelerometer. A website can't access, you know, my contacts, but this app can because of that line of code. I don't mention it in my notes, but I'm going to mention it now because it's optional. Do you see any difference between the three lines of JavaScript that were already there and the line we just plugged in?
Yeah.
What's the thing?
Right.
Type. This script does not have a type. I mean, it does have a type, and these don't. I believe I mentioned it briefly before, and I'll mention it again. When we're dealing with HTML5, HTML5 now assumes that any block of script that is referenced is JavaScript. A few years ago, I would have to specify the script that follows is JavaScript. It's not ASP, it's not CGI, it's not PHP, whatever. It's JavaScript. Now, because we're dealing with a modern HTML5 project, any script is assumed to be JavaScript. So, to me, I don't like that it says that. If you take it out or leave it in, it doesn't matter. But people sometimes care about how pretty their code looks, how consistent it looks, and this is totally optional. I don't like that it's got one weird line that doesn't look the same as the rest, so I'm going to take that out. You don't have to. You can leave it alone and it'll still work. Now, pretty. All looks the same, consistent. And so there's something to be said about making your code work and making your code look nice in the process. So this still is equivalent. This is JavaScript. Back on my handout, okay, we already did this. Remove the following lines. We don't need the lines that say Apple mobile web apps. It's not going to be a web app anymore. It's going to be a real app. We would want to do this also. I called it here dir file, but the map file. We'll do that later. I don't want to break our stride at the moment. 7. We'll open the CSS, the old index CSS file, and we're going to copy some code there into our current CSS file to orient ourselves. Back in the folder from last month, we have codica.external.css. We got that when we created our project a while ago via Codica. Remember that framework that we used to put together a project? It created a little placeholder CSS file for us, which is empty. No, actually, we added a little bit to it, I think. But this template, this taco template, has a little bit of built-in CSS that I think is useful for us. And it's inside of the CSS folder. So open up the CSS folder. There's an index file there, CSS. Right-click it, edit with Notepad. And I need to open... So back to the folder, and I also need to open the Codica CSS file. I need to transfer some of the code from the template CSS file to the new CSS file. Right-click, edit Notepad there. And one thing that I've noticed for Notepad, it gets confused. Depending on which tab you have open, it'll then further open more tabs there. I would like to see my old code here and my new code there. So you can juggle that back and forth. This is one of the things that's a little cumbersome on Notepad++. I want to put this index file back to the left, so you have to right-click it, move to other view. There we go. So the template code is on the left. My new code is on the right. Doesn't matter where it is, but the point is my handout is saying I need to copy this line of code here, this definition of body. There's some CSS built into the Taco project that has a few useful things to make it feel more like an app. You've got these lines right here, WebKit touch callout none. This says prevents callout to copy image, etc. when tap to hold. When you're on a website, on your device, you can usually tap and hold and save a picture. Well, we don't want that on our app. That doesn't make sense. You never can do that in a real app. You can't do that on Facebook or Instagram that you tap and hold, like the logo of Instagram. I can't save the logo of Instagram. And our app could do that. We don't want that. So we've got WebKit touch callout none. Don't make a callout when someone taps and holds something. We also don't want the ability for people to resize the size of their text. You know, by zooming in and zooming out and doing weird things. We are going to set the size of the text that'll look well on their device. We don't want people to then drag and select for parts of the text to copy and paste it like a website. You don't actually do that also on most apps. So those are three little overrides there. We're throwing in a background color. That's probably that dark background color that's behind everything. We'll probably change that later. We're choosing a font family here. Roboto Regular, or Droid Sans, or Sego, etc. This list of fonts. If this app loads up on an Android device, our app will search for the font Roboto Regular and use that font in our app. If it can't find that font on the device, it'll try the second one. Droid Sans. If you can't find that one, it'll go to the next one, Sego, however you pronounce that. If it doesn't find that one, which is Sego UI, it'll look for Sego. Then after that, if it doesn't find that one, on and on and on, over here, San Francisco, Helvetica New, Helvetica, so all the way down to the most generic Sans Serif. You know, very plain, basic font. later on, when we fully customize our app and such, we will be able to choose any font that is not listed here, and it doesn't matter if the font is available or not on the device. We will be able to choose any crazy font we want, and it will work. We'll get to that later. But at the moment, this is how we set our font for our app. And this will work for Android or iPhone or Windows Phone, because the iPhone doesn't have Roboto Regular, so it'll skip it. It doesn't have Droid, so it'll skip it. It doesn't have Sego, so it'll skip it. But it does have San Francisco. Modern iPhones do. Let's say it's an older iPhone. Doesn't have it? Okay, try Helvetica New. Doesn't have that? Try the next one. So, and then a font size, 12 pixels, which I actually don't like. I don't like to set this as actual hard pixel values. 12 pixels does not grow and shrink depending on the size of the device. We're going to copy this line of code, and then we're going to change that. From the old index file, make sure you copy the whole chunk of body, including that curly brace. Select it and copy it. Don't forget that curly brace. And in the Codeca file, we'll set that at the very top, because this takes, this is applied in order, remember, top to bottom. I want this stuff to be set as soon as the project loads. So I suppose, you know, right before aside, give yourself some space, paste it in. Copying the body CSS into Codeca CSS before anything else so we can set some defaults right away. What I'm saying I don't like is I don't like to set values of fonts, especially where they are a hard value. Pixels are pixels are pixels. These dots don't really change well. They're not proportional. They don't grow. They don't shrink depending on the size of the device. A better thing to have here is either M's or percentages. We're going to use percentages because they make more sense. M's are like percentages but work on a different scale. So we'll say instead of 12 pixels, we'll say 100%. Whatever the device is, whichever font is available, make it a default 100% size. Sometimes that's a little small to read, actually, so we'll kick it up just a little bit, 105%. Make it slightly larger than normal so that it's a little more readable. And when it's on a nice big device, it'll still be nice and big and readable. It'll grow and shrink proportionally to the device that it's on. I'm going to save that CSS file. This color, I'm not sure what color it is. It's probably some sort of gray. We'll work with that later. Back to my notes. Next, I need to copy a little bit of JavaScript. In the scripts folder, I have an index.js file, and I'm going to need to copy some of these lines into my codeca.external.js. So what I'm saying here is I go back to the folder, and then this time inside of the scripts folder, we have index.js, right-click, edit with Notepad, ++. I also then need to open the codeca.external.js file in Notepad. I don't have anything in the Codeca file at the moment. I got a bunch of stuff in my index.js. I need that whole 26 lines, so select all of that. And I'll paste it into line 2.
Everything, right?
Everything, yeah. I have some more notes there on the handout that say, because thinking ahead, when you want to do this, when you're excited about what we did today and you want to do it again from scratch on the weekend, and then you've already worked on it and such, I have a note some here. I have a few notes here extra that you might want to look at, where I say, you know, copy everything in. If you had any pre-existing JavaScript code, make sure it's inside the function on device ready. I mentioned this previously, where the whole purpose of this file is that one of the first things that happens is it's waiting for the trigger for the event device ready. Once device ready is emitted by the app, we're ready to use the camera, we're ready to use the contacts, etc. So once that event is encountered, it will then run the onDevice function, which is defined on line 7. So anything related to the app that we needed to actually do, any JavaScript that we're going to write, should then be inside of this function, onDeviceReady. Short answer is that's just the way it has to be. You read the documentation, it'll tell you over and over and over, onDeviceReady, the importance of it. Short answer is just make sure we're going to see all of our code. 99% of our code is going to be in onDeviceReady. So if you already have a project that you're working with and are trying to turn it into an app like us, make sure you put your JavaScript code anywhere inside of the function onDeviceReady. Doesn't matter to us because we didn't have anything in our JS file. Remove lines 14 to 16, which mentions some stuff that we don't need anymore. So what I'm saying here, if the line numbers match up, right here, 14 to 16. This was what was making that work a little while ago, that we had the Cordova mascot, and we had the little glowing device ready. Remember that? That was this right here. We don't need that anymore. So everything here, var element, etc., element.innerHTML, element.class, delete all of that. I guess we can delete that comment too, but I'll leave it for the moment. That's good there. We took out code that we don't need anymore. And then on the handout, I have one more thing. This one's a bit optional, but this is also to check that everything's working. There's so many parts or so many times within this whole process that something could go wrong, especially when we're talking about JavaScript. So we're going to use console output a lot to check, is this code working? Something's supposed to happen on screen, it's not happening. What's going on? I have to check the console. Remember the console from last month. So we're going to use console output to give ourselves feedback to see if things are working. So I've got here, to the first line inside of the function onDeviceReady, add console.log, Cordova is ready. We're giving ourselves a message in the console that if we got this far, and if we see Cordova is ready, we're ready. We're ready to go on with our project. So what I'm saying is, on the Codica file, on line 8, so before the splash screen, before or after, I guess it doesn't quite matter, but I'll add it right after here, like I said on my handout, console.log. Console is that screen in the monitor or the web browser where we can see errors and output. It's the object, the console object. Remember, we talked about objects briefly last month. We'll talk about more JavaScript a lot more this month. And we're running the method log. We're going to log. We're going to write something to the console. In quotes, we will write a human-friendly or a developer-friendly message, which is simply Cordova is ready. Remember, Cordova is synonymous with taco, synonymous with phone gap. Doesn't matter. No, it doesn't matter at this instant. We are seeing a mix in here and there of singles and doubles. It doesn't matter unless you've got quotes inside of quotes.
And then is there a specific way that you do it, or you just have to match?
They have to match, definitely. So if I had double quotes around the whole thing here, then I would need single quotes here. If I had single quotes around the whole thing, I would need double quotes here. I don't want to do double quotes, that'll break things.
Okay.
All right, do that, save and close all files, now delete. Okay, so just to make sure this is all good, a quick thing to do, remember, if you click on, I've already done it, but if you click on that icon there, that saves all your files at once. That's also the same as file save all or control shift S. And I want to save all my files. And then I want to go to file close all. It has no shortcut or icon. I've copied files, I've saved files, edited code. I'm done with it for the moment. We'll do help and lab time in just a moment. Break time. But go ahead and save and close all. And then we've got now delete your old code. This assumes you copied it all in properly, like I did. If you haven't properly, or you're not sure if you've copied it over just right, you don't have to delete it yet. You can delete it at any point. You don't even have to delete it. You can leave those files hanging around. They're never going to be accessible or usable or used, but they're going to take up resources, you know, space in your app. So I'm going to delete them because I know I copied it all over. If you're not quite sure, you don't have to. But I'm saying we no longer need this index2 file, we no longer need the CSS file, and we no longer need the scripts folder. Delete them both.
That's because we're using the Cordica CSS and the
exactly.
CSS.
We took what we needed from those scripts and CSS files and we put them into our own files. And we don't need that placeholder index anymore. Delete that. In Node.js command prompt, type taco build, and then taco run. I'm going to skip taco build because remember, taco run or taco emulate will build it for you. I'm just going to skip that so that we can see this. And I've got an emulator running, so I will do taco emulate Android. And if you've got a real device running, go ahead and run Android and see how your project from last month comes into the app world. Taking a humble web project, and we're updating it with Taco to be a real project. And as I said previously, it's almost as easy as dragging and dropping your web stuff into an Android, into a Taco template. And what I meant by almost was that handout. You need to copy some of that code over. Once that's copied over, then you have this foundation. And so when we do taco build or taco run or taco emulate, it compiles it all again. It checks that everything's new. There's a lot of new things in our project now. So again, it might take a little longer to compile at this point because there's a lot of new stuff to deal with. It will be up to date for the next time and it should go faster. Subsequent builds. Earlier it took me like 3 minutes to build it and then now it seems to be going faster. What I like to do is, either on my real device or virtual, I like to hit it back to the home screen, not in the app. I like to go back to the home screen like this so that I know it loads the latest version of it. And again, sometimes it looks like it gets stuck. What I would do is, especially if you're running this off of your flash drive, check your flash drive if it's blinking. You know, if you've got a flash drive that blinks, that'll give you some feedback to tell you something's happening. Sometimes you don't get any good feedback from the console. It'll definitely tell you when you make a mistake, but it often doesn't tell you when you do a good job. Yes?
So, we've updated an app that we loaded onto your phone last time. Mm-hmm. And you don't really have an indication that it's a new app, except that you maybe deleted the old one, or that maybe we changed the splash screen a little bit.
The indication is the project that we created last month. Everything that we did last month should now come back. So if you have that splash screen now that we designed painstakingly last time, it loaded up for a moment and then the app came up, and then try to go to the different screens. It's not quite ready yet. There's still a couple rough around the edges things. But look at that. The project we made last month, which was a website, especially if you're running it off your real device, this is pretty impressive. So, if it worked, great. Let me just get a quick show of hands. How many of you did it work for? Great. Okay, let's take our break. It's about 7:20. We'll be back at 7:30. If you didn't quite get it to work, check that handout. I'm going to turn the printer back on and call me over if you need any help. Yes.